Chapter. And I want to begin reading at verse 24. I'm reading from the English Standard Version. You follow along in your Bible. My version, I believe, will be on the screen. Beginning right at verse 24, you'll find these words. Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails and to place my finger into the mark of the nails and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. And although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him and said, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen me and yet believe. Amen. You may be seated in the very presence of our God. Thomas said, I won't believe it's him unless I see the scars, unless I see the wounds. When Jesus came in the room, Jesus said to him, look at the scars. Look at the wounds, touch them. I want to preach for just a few minutes about there's a sermon in my scars. There's a sermon in my scars. This is after the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The disciples have all gone their own way. They have fled. They have run in fear, not only of the Jews, but in fear also of Rome. Because the rumor has been put out that the body of Jesus has been stolen. Jesus has appeared to the disciples, and where the text takes up, it lets us know that all of them saw him but Thomas. It's very interesting the way the text is worded, because the text says that Thomas was not with them when they saw Jesus. He missed his moment to have an encounter with the Christ. But if you continue to read the other verses, you will discover that even though he missed his first moment, he gets another chance. I don't want to make anybody shout, and I'm not going to raise my voice, but the reason some of us can shout tonight is because in 2008, we missed some moments where we should have been with Jesus. The reality is all of us in here have had some moments where we missed, but aren't you glad tonight that he'll give you another chance? Is there anybody up in here tonight that's not ashamed to testify that I missed him when I should have caught him, but he covered me until I got another chance? I know you want to be stuck up tonight, and I know you don't want anybody to know I'm talking about you, but somebody can be honest enough to admit tonight, Bishop is on my street because I missed him when I should have been in church. I missed him when I should have been praying. I missed him when I should have been reading his word, but thank you that he covered me all year long. And tonight, on the last night of the year, he's giving me another chance. Touch your neighbor and tell him I've got another chance to see Jesus. And this time I won't mess it up. Jesus comes into the room, and when Jesus comes into the room, he immediately goes to Thomas and he says, see the scars, touch the scars. And it is upon touching the scars and seeing the scars that Thomas begins to believe that this is in fact Jesus the Christ. There's something about the scars of Jesus that preached a sermon to Thomas that nothing else could preach to him. Y'all, there's something about scars. They have a story behind them. I've got two. I've got one in the front, and I've got one in the back. There's something about scars that tells something about what you've been through. Now, I know that doesn't resonate with many of us because we spend all of our time hiding our scars. We don't want anybody to see the ugliness. We don't want anybody to see what we've been through because we spend all of our time trying to impress folk that we don't even like. So you spend all of your time trying to hide your history and hide the things you've been through. But tonight, I want to tell you, watch me now, that scars are proof of something you've been through. God help me for just 10 minutes. God, I didn't say they're proof of what you're going through. Scars are proof of something you've already been through. Scars are proof of something you went through and you survived. Scars are the evidence that you survived something that was horrific in your life. And I've got the scars to prove it. Jesus says to him, these are the scars, watch me now, that I got while I was on the cross. And the reason you can see my scars is because I'm no longer on the cross. I've already come through the worst part of what they tried to do to me. See, you don't get scars while you're going through. You get scars after you've been through. And there's somebody in Bethel tonight who can say, 2008, I got some scars. I went through some things. I've been through some things. I've had some pain. I've had some tears. But how many of y'all tonight can say, look at my scars? Because the scars are the evidence that I've been through. Okay, let me get you real quick. One of my favorite movies is Lethal Weapon. And in Lethal Weapon 2, Mel Gibson falls in love with Rene Russo. And before they start having their little affair, they have a tit for tat about their scars. He tells her, I got this scar in this battle. And she says, well, I got this scar in this battle. Then he says, well, I got this scar in this battle. And she says, well, I got this scar in that battle. Y'all ain't caught it yet. It was as if their wounds became their trophies to celebrate their victories. See, all I want to tell somebody tonight is that your scars are not to be hidden, but your scars are to be your trophy to testify to the devil that you tried, but you did not win. Now, can I give about 10 minutes and I'll be through? Because my scars have a sermon. Now, most of y'all don't know how I got my scars, so let me just tell you how I got them. The devil attacked my back. When you read Ephesians and you discover the armor of God, you will discover the only place there's no armor is on your back, because the devil tries to attack areas where he thinks you're unprotected. But what the devil doesn't realize is that God gives you the responsibility to cover other areas, and what he doesn't tell you to cover, he covers himself. See, some of y'all got some unprotected areas, and God sent me by to tell you tonight, make sure that the devil can't get access to your unprotected areas. You better cover them. You better pray over them. You better anoint them. He attacked my back, y'all. And let me tell you how I came to this sermon. I was on the elevator at Mayo, and a woman saw this scar right here. And she said, oh, what in the world happened to you? Huh. The scar let her know I had been through something. She could see the evidence that I had had a struggle. But she didn't know the extent of everything I went through. See, people see your scars and then try to judge you about who you are. But they don't have a clue everything you've been through. People see your scars and try to determine who you are, but they don't understand the reason you shout like you shout and run like you run and act crazy like you do. It ain't because of the scars. It's because of what you went through before you got your scars. When you touch your neighbor real quick and tell him you don't even know, you don't have a clue the nights I cried. You don't have a clue the days I couldn't pay my bills. You don't have a clue the days my husband called me out of my name. You don't have a clue the nights I didn't know where my child was. You don't have a clue the days the doctor told me I wouldn't make it. But through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus, and I've learned to trust in God. High five somebody and tell them, you see my scar, but you don't know my story. I've got a story behind my scar. So I went on to tell the woman what I'd been through. She didn't know I'd been on a respirator for 24 hours. She didn't know that when I first came out of surgery, they had me in critical care with a respirator because I couldn't breathe on my own. She didn't know that for all of that time, I was in a back brace. She didn't know that for 4 months, I slept in a recliner. That's why every now and then, you got to tell for what you've been through. See, I don't have time for Christians anymore who want to act persnickety and stuck up in church like they ain't never been through nothing. Baby, I'ma tell it every chance I get, so the devil will know that whatever he did, he meant it for evil. I'm almost through. I'm almost through. So let me tell you how I got my scars. Let me tell you how I got my scars. Well, I was having some tingling in my left arm and some numbing in my right hand, and we knew there was a problem. HB, I was displaying symptoms, but I didn't know what was causing it. I knew something was wrong, but I didn't have the expertise to come to a conclusion about my condition. I had to admit something was wrong and go to somebody else that had the knowledge to discover what it was. God help me in here. See, sometimes you can know something ain't right in your life, but until you are ready to admit it, God help me tonight. James Baldwin said, you can't fix what you will not face. And sometimes you've got to admit that something's wrong with you, but you've got to also admit that you don't have what it takes to fix it on your own. That's why some of y'all are here tonight. You know something's wrong with you. 2008's been a rough year. You've been sleeping here, there, and everywhere. You've been drinking this, that, and the other, and you know it's symptomatic of a problem, but I know somebody who can diagnose your situation and turn your life around. See, you got to admit that God has not designed any of us with the level of expertise that allows us to fix ourselves. You got to have a desire to fix it, but you got to be able to seek out those whom God has gifted to help you beyond your own limited ability. So I went to the doctor. I'm almost through. Went to the doctor. The doctor put me in an MRI. Scariest thing I've been in my life. Because they put you in this thing, and there's, you know, it's not like a CAT scan. CAT scan is open on both sides. MRI, it ain't open on the other side. I felt like I was in my tomb. I said, hey, take me back out of this. Let me pray and get myself together. They put me in this thing and did an MRI. Watch this. The MRI was designed to see my skeletal frame to determine exactly where and what was causing the problem. I was having tingling in my arm. But the MRI revealed that what I was manifesting wasn't really the problem. Y'all missed it. Because more often than not, your problem cannot be determined by outer manifestations. Preach, Bishop. See, you are acting a certain way, but that ain't really what's wrong with you. You got to let the Holy Ghost do an MRI on your heart to discover what's wrong with you on the end. There's got to be some soul searching to determine the root of your issue. After discovering there was a problem, y'all, it was determined that the only way to fix it was to have surgery. Tell your neighbor, he about to bless you. Which means I had to be cut in order to be made better. Sometimes the road to fixing a condition goes through a city called pain. Help somebody tonight, Bishop, that every now and then you've got to allow the Lord to cut you in places you don't want to be cut. You got to allow the Lord to hurt you in places you don't want to be hurt. See, I had discovered, y'all, that one of my problems was I spent all my time with God to preach, but didn't spend my time with God to grow. So God said, I'm going to allow some pain in your life to put you on your back where you ain't got to preach for 4 months. And the only reason you got to talk to me is to get closer to me. Maybe what you're going through is God's way of trying to get your attention. Maybe the pain you're feeling is God getting ready to fix you. I don't know who I'm talking to tonight, but is there anybody in pain tonight? Is there anybody going through a cutting tonight? God told me to tell you, he's not cutting you to hurt you. He's cutting you to fix you. So after the surgery came my recovery, and in the midst of my recovery, about 2 weeks after being home, I started having pain in my right side. And they discovered that I had 4 blood clots in my right lung, 2 blood clots in my left lung at the same time. Blood condition called lupus anticoagulation, where I may have to be on Coumadin for the rest of my life. Only discovered because I had a back problem. So several new conditions were discovered as a result of the, isn't it amazing how other issues can be discovered when you are opened up by a process to fix something else? Am I talking to anybody? Has God ever fixed one area, but while he was fixing one area, you discovered you had some other areas where you needed the Lord to work it out? And is there anybody in here who can say he can work it out? I got about 5 minutes, about 6 minutes, Dougie Fresh in his own. Watch this. So here I am, clots, and then my throat, my instrument, that which I use to perform my assignment. Because the devil is not through until he attacks you in the area of your destiny. Contrary to what you hear in some of these preachers on TV, he ain't after your money. He doesn't need it. He ain't after your children. He ain't trying to parent. He ain't after your husband, your wife. He ain't trying to get married. The devil is after your destiny, because he may have lost the battle for your soul, but he's still in the battle for your destiny. And he will do whatever he can to destroy your destiny. So he attacks. My throat. And then I started developing these scars. I was having days of pain. Wanted the pain to go away. Until I discovered that the pain was the evidence that I was healing. The pain wasn't the evidence that something was still wrong. The pain was the evidence that I was healing. Anybody in pain tonight, God help me. Anybody going through a struggle tonight, God told me to tell you that doesn't mean something's wrong. It means you're on the mend. High five three people real quick and tell them, I'm on the mend. I'm being fixed. That's why I'm crying. I'm being fixed. That's why I'm struggling. I'm being fixed. That's why I hurt. I'm being fixed. That's why I can't go to sleep. The devil should have killed me when he had a chance. But since I survived, the struggle is over. Oh, I'm done. I forgot to tell you this. Before they sewed me back up, they put some cadaver bones inside me. Now, if you don't know what cadaver bones are, those are bones of dead folk. I got two things to tell you, and the second one, y'all been trying to sit so y'all don't make me shout, but the second one, y'all better shout, because I'm gonna sit down. The first thing the doctor told me was, the cadaver bones are gonna help you grow a couple of inches. So something had to die for me to grow. God help me. I don't know who I'm talking to tonight, but some of y'all better kill some stuff tonight. Because 2009 is the year of your growth. Kill some friendships. Kill some attitudes. Kill some dispositions. How many of y'all tonight can say, I'm killing some stuff? Because I'm ready to grow. Take one person by the hand and tell them, I'm ready to grow. I'm cutting out some people. I'm changing my phone number. I'm blocking some phone numbers. I'm not responding to some emails. I'm not talking to some folk no more. All the negative folk I'm leaving behind. All the arrogant folk I'm leaving behind. All the only go to church on New Year's Eve folk I'm leaving behind. Because I'm ready to grow. But here's the shout, HB, God help me. Here's the shout. They had to put dead bones in me for me to live. Somebody had to die so I could keep on living. Y'all missed it right there. I'm getting out of here because I ain't gonna push myself. But you know why you ought to shout tonight? Because the only reason you can live is because somebody died in your place. Would you high five your neighbor real quick and tell your neighbor, I'm living because he died for me. I'm living because he died so I could live. I'm standing because he died in my place. High five your neighbor real quick and tell him Bishop ain't gonna push it. Tell him he ain't gonna holler. But he gotta do one thing. Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he fight your battles? Won't he make your enemies your footstool? Won't he give you joy and sorrow? Won't he give you hope for tomorrow? Won't he dry your teeth? Won't he, won't he, won't he, won't he, won't he? Yeah. Yeah.
chance, but I'm so glad I got more than dead bones, cause he didn't stay dead. They buried him all night Friday, buried him all day Saturday, but early, I said early, early, early. I gotta holler one time for the doctor. Somebody say it. He did die. He did die. But he got up.
Your scars are sermons. Quit hiding what you've been through. Quit acting like you ain't been through it. That scar becomes the testimony of your survival. The only reason Jesus had wounds is because he survived the cross. Whatever scars you got in 2008, don't say I'm leaving them in 2008. No, no. Take that with you. Because the scars that you got in 2008 become the testimonies of 2009. Some of y'all had a mighty rough year. Some of y'all had a year worse than mine. Because no matter what you go through, there's always somebody worse off than you. The good news is, he died.